Do you think that culture is ever talked about in the same sentence as climate change?
We never thought about the climate change is going to affect the cultural space, but the reality is really affecting it. One is if you take a potter, the pottery, because they depend on the river, and every season, then after the flood, the river will have a room for flowing. And that is, when the river overflows, they have a floodplains. The floodplains are places where then the river, when the overflows, that is managed in the floodplains. And when the due to land encroachments and kind of mining and all the things, the river has gone down, the because of the sand has taken out. So the river length, its depth has increased. And the floodplains are not getting flooded during the monsoon season. That really affected the accumulation of clay or raw materials, which mainly used by the potters. And the people involved in traditional occupation, it's not purely a single occupation. It's a part of their life. The pottery, bell metal, or weaving you take, it's so interlinked or so connected with their life. Their rituals, beliefs, food habits, the lifestyle, the whole life cycle is revolving around that, their occupation. So you cannot never separate out, like, I'm an IT engineer. I can always say, that's not really connected with my performance or my culture or anything, So that's separate. But a pottery is actually the workshop they do once in a year. They go to the river Nila and do the workshop because they're getting the clay from the river goddess. And so that's actually so interlinked,
Do you think enough people realize that connection?
We still look at the climate change or the kind of environmental degradation which is happening, which is something like, close to certain set of people, or it's something like a scientific or a technological space, but it's happening. But in a layman's side or in the local context, things are not really communicated. So that, in that sense, definitely that awareness is not there. Because if people stop the agriculture practices, what will happen? So that definitely, because agriculture is actually a big process where you have so much communities involved in, a lot of cultural activities involved in. We have a lot of harvest festivals and people are shifting. That's a main reason. Youngsters shifting from village to city, and then urban folklore is getting widened or expanded. But the rural area, the only age people are there in the rural area, the younger generation getting shifted to city. So that's why they don't have people to continue their tradition. So that's why slowly, slowly that is getting vanished.
Can you tell our readers a little more about how the people in your district in Kerala were affected by climate change?
The climate change impact, especially climate impacts in the Western Ghats, started affecting us very badly. And the monsoons are not regular. So due to that, the floods are happening. Dams are not able to manage properly the water coming in. And the landslides are happening. A lot of construction happening, destruction happening, especially on the hills and everywhere. That is creating the landslides and everything. So flood is the one side. And the recent problem which we are facing as part of the climate change is actually, it's mainly because the landsliding, especially the hill areas, the center part of Kerala, mainly affected due to landslides. That's mainly because of the quarries and all this kind of illegal mining activities. So climate change is one way we are directly affecting it. We are directly facing it.
So what prompted you to look at the percussionists and potters in your area?
Wiley, actually, it's a folk group that started in 2004.
Yes.
We gathered mainly for creating a platform for youth for learning and understanding the traditional knowledge systems, especially folk art forms and culture. And during our exercise, we realized that our interventions are required in other areas like the craftsmen, people involved in the traditional occupations like bell metal craft or terracotta or weaving or mat weaving or cloth weaving, different traditional occupation people. So they are not in the mainstream, they are not part of any of the mainstream exercises. So we want to support people who are involved in the traditional costume making, instrument making, all sorts of activities along with our performance. So we started another group. It was called Echo Bazaar. Now it is called Craftilla. The Craftilla, the innovators of craft. And we are concentrating our efforts to connect them with the market and try to help them to find good market, work with the designers, which will go easily in the current market situations. That's the idea. So we have folk expressions. We have a contemporary bamboo band, which looks after the percussion or performance space. And we have Craftilla, which will be working closely with the craft people or traditional people involved in the traditional occupation.
So what was your first step? What was the first workshop you took with children in your village like?
The spark or the inspiration came to form Wiley was from the Center for Folklore Studies. It's a group in Thrissur, in our area, a group of researchers and academicians involved in a very serious research on folklore and traditional knowledge. And they inspired us to start, you know, something looking at, you know, connecting youth into that. So that was the motive. And when we started folk expressions, we realized that, you know, the Center for Folklore Studies, they used to arrange many workshops, especially in colleges and schools, and they go and talk about folklore, traditional knowledge, the importance to protect and, you know, do some preservation activities. So since we are part of that exercise, you know, we also brought into the kind of picture. And what we realize is that when we go to schools or colleges, talking to them for almost 40 to 1 hour, they get totally, you know, disturbed or, you know, exhausted, you know, if you take a presentations or anything. So rather than talking to someone, you know, longer, we thought, let's have sort of a performance kind of exercise. You know, we take our instruments and then we sing and dance, and then we'll explain to them the importance of, see, this song is from this community. They are involved in this kind of custom tradition. So that's why when we start and perform, they can very easily connect with their roots. So that's what we experienced it.
How did you actually make the revival of traditional knowledge inviting for the young, and also keep it authentic at the same time?
We don't want to dilute the values of a traditional performance or the ethics or the way the system was transitioning from generation to generation, either through orally or other mechanisms, because they have their own teaching mechanisms, teaching methodology. So we want to continue the same the pattern. And at the same time, we should be creating space for the youngsters to explore their potentials and their interests and their talents. So Bamboo team, what we have envisaged is actually, that's a space for creative actions. So in Bamboo, we don't have any, it's a contemporary band, and we don't have any boundary. So as a youngster, you are free to do whatever you want to do in the Bamboo. You can go and perform anything you want, you can do. But when it comes to the folk dance performance or folk singing, we will make sure that, you know, we'll retain the kind of whatever we learned from our masters.
Is it challenging to regenerate people's confidence in being able to earn a living from the arts?
That's really challenging. Very honestly, Wiley has been there in the field for the last 18 years. And we were never successful in getting one person living, you know, only through the income from the art practices. That's very, 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 very hard in these days. That's mainly because the performing spaces are getting degraded diminished. So you don't have much spaces in the society to perform. So that's the main reason for, you know, getting income. Second, compared to other fields like, you know, construction or another employment opportunities, people are well paid. And artist, he takes a lot of time and effort and pain to become an artist, the kind of effort he takes to learn the art form and practices, and the kind of benefit he gets paid for the kind of effort he is taking is very less compared to other spaces. So that's why if you talk to any artisan, if you talk to any artist, they never say they want to keep their kids in the same field. They say, somehow I stuck with that, you know, I'm trapped here. And I don't want my kid to continue, you know, let him go and learn something and get into an employment. So that's why they don't see any future in the life, you know, if they took art or craft as their practice. That has to be changed, you know. We need to treat them with a dignity, and we have to provide them with a kind of, you know, facility wherein an artist or a craft person feels comfortable to train his kids to continue the profession and, you know, the tradition. That's that's where really important. Compartmentalization is still there. You know, if you take any traditional or folk performances or classical or other performances, we still have so much compartmentalization in our art forms, like traditional art forms or what do you call classical art forms or this kind of things. So people who are involved in the traditional art forms or classical, they treated allied, you know, so they'll get good paid. You know, if you're calling in Carnatic musician and ask him to do a concert, he'll be gently paid. And at the same time, if you call a folk singer coming and sitting and sing it, so you don't even pay him half, actually, what you pay to the Carnatic, you don't even pay half. So that's actually that disparity or the separation is still there in the society. So that has to be changed, actually.
So for someone just starting out in this space, what would your advice to them be?
Unlike traditional or classical art forms, they are trained from childhood and then become full-time artists, especially Carnatic musicians or Kathakali or Mohiniyattam, or those kind of art forms we call as traditional or classical. They treated alike and then they get paid. But unlike other folk art forms, so the area which I work or widely work is mainly because of they are treated lower caste or lower in the pyramid, especially folk arts, and that's so tied with their life and the culture and the life systems what they practice, and many of the rituals, beliefs, performance are not like in paid exclusive performance shows. So those are treated part of their rituals and festivals, so no regular income coming in, and if they perform, that be treated as their duty for the community or anything. So there should be some hand holding and shaking required for people to treat them alike and then take it. So that's actually the important aspect.
As an organizer of the Nila International Folklore Film Festival, could you please tell us what this festival is about?
Festival Nila International Folklore Film Festival, NIFI, we have started last year, 2020. And we were thinking about how do we connect youth or young generation or the media which they use with the folklore or tradition. So we thought film could be a good medium. And from our earlier experience in connecting youth with the media, that got us a lot of results. So we were thinking, we started a media collective called Bhima Wiley Initiative for Media Action in 2017. So from there onwards, we have a good collection of people, involved in media activities. So we thought, let's start sort of a festival. And it's an opportunity for our own people to get to know about the culture, tradition from across the globe. And we can learn how are they making use of the medium like a cinema to document and then convey the message of the kind of degradation happening to there. How do we continue? It's like, if we can create a platform in our community, in our village, monthly basis, at least we can screen, because as a part of festival, we'll be definitely identifying best films and we'll be giving awards and everything. But that's part of the procedure of the festival. But we don't want to segregate films, because these films are not mainstream films. These films are taken by people with a lot of passion, a lot of energy, and a lot of resources have gone into making such films. So we thought we should appreciate all the films which are coming to us through a regular basis. So week monthly basis, we can screen this film. And we should create a platform in our village, especially among the youth, to come in, appreciate the film, sit together and enjoy the film. So through the films, we can communicate the culture. And that's our core mandate. And we are also planning to start a quarterly newsletter sort of thing, which we can connect with the youngsters who are involved in the cultural research space. So they can start writing. So intellectual academic activities with the film, that's what we are envisaging with this.